Welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harvey.
And my name is Stephen A. Mackay.
We're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV and games.
Oh, and we also talk about Hawkwind and naked dancers from time to time.
The dancers at the end of time, perhaps. On today's episode, we're delighted to welcome to the podcast author Jean Gill. According to Jean's website, she is a Welsh writer and photographer living in the south of France with two scruffy dogs, a Nikon D750, a beehive called Endeavour, and a man. She's published all kinds of books, both with conventional publishers and self-published, from prize-winning poetry, novels, military history, to a cookery book on goat cheese, or goat cheese even. Jean's latest novel is called The Ringbreaker and is set in the 12th century. And the strapline from the book is, "In the twilight of the gods, when the last Vikings rule the seas, two cursed orphans meet on an Orkney beach and their fates collide." So, welcome, Jean.
Hello, Jean.
Thank you very much. Good to be here.
Great.
So, Jean, can you tell us a bit about The Ringbreaker and the inspiration behind it?
Well, Matthew's just done the first bit, and I couldn't do it better than that.
Well, I was actually going to do the.
I thought after I started doing it, I thought I could have done the American sort of voiceover,
the movie voiceover. You know,
like, yeah. In the twilight of the old gods. But I didn't.
Carry on.
No.
Too late.
No, I don't think so. And Stephen could have done it with an Orkney accent, so that is lined up for another time.
I don't know about that. I think my accent's slightly different from that far north.
It certainly is. It's almost into a Norwegian accent, I found. So, inspiration. I went to a Historical Novel Society conference in Glasgow in 2018. And took the chance to have some solo time because I quite like being on my own because it never happens. And took my camera off to Orkney for a few days because I'd always wanted to see some of the more remote Scottish islands from my childhood in Scotland. I just had this romantic idea about them. And in my Troubadours series set in the 12th century, there's an Orkney prince who goes on pilgrimage and just stops off in Narbonne. And it really happened, which to me was amazing. And that was all I knew about 12th century Orkney. I wasn't really thinking about books. I was thinking about photos and scenery and soul time. And I went to Maeshowe. I think that's how you say it, because I always get it muddled with the Welsh pronunciation. But it's the prehistoric site on mainland Orkney. And I thought, yeah, prehistoric history. Oh, it's really great. And I stood there in this prehistoric tomb, knowing bugger all about it. And then the guide said that I was surrounded by Viking graffiti, that all around me in that prehistoric chamber were 12th century runes carved by a group of Vikings in my special period, who'd broken into the tomb, probably during bad weather, all of that's a bit vague. And among these carvings, dating back to the same time, is the Maeshowe dragon. So this exquisite little dragon carved on the wall. So it's graffiti, but it's beautiful, it's history. And It just blew me away completely. Absolutely.
That's amazing. It's amazing when you just, something like that just touches you and you feel like that you're touching the past, that you are
magic.
Exactly. Yeah, it's the magic of sort of time travel almost. It's strange.
It's exactly that. And you know what it's like with your books as well. When you go to a place and it grabs you, doesn't it? And it says, write about me, write about me.
Well, I just last week I was in Florence and Lucca in Tuscany, and nothing to do with the sort of periods that I'm writing about, but just being there for a few days surrounded by Renaissance history, you know, it's very difficult not to feel the sort of the pull of the history of a place when there's so much history there. And like you say, in this remote place in Orkney, having that something that someone's hands have touched and chiseled and made some piece of artwork, you know, and there's other bits of graffiti in the walls, and it's incredible. So do you know what things were written?
Is it clean enough? Yeah, clean enough for the podcast?
No, a lot of it isn't. So I'll tell you that after the podcast is over.
You can say anything. We can leave it in already.
No, well, I asked the guide what the runes said, because I have had no background in Old Norse, never mind in runes. And some of them she told me, others she didn't know. And I sort of mentally put it aside that I would track all this down for later. And I vaguely thought I'd write a short story to go with the troubadours, you know, that makes sense. But it's too big for that. So once I'd finished the fantasy trilogy I was working on, I started the research properly. And I splashed out €100, which is a lot of money for me, on a history book which has got all the runes with all the possible interpretations from that burial chamber. And it's just my precious. It's wonderful. Because among the runes is one that states that they're the pilgrims, and it's written by Leif, the Jarl's housekeeper, and it's a female name.
This is a character from your book.
Yeah. So she's real.
Right.
But that's the only thing anybody knows about her, is that she was in there carving, that she was amongst those who went on a long ship on this journey of pilgrimage to Jerusalem in the mid-12th century.
Wow.
And so within this history non-fiction book, I had all the runes, but of course you've got no timeline on them. And you've got only the names of people. And most of them are like, well, I don't know what the public toilets are like in your neck of the woods. But when I lived in Llanelli, you know, you shut the door and you read Fred was here in a variety of ways. And that's what Viking runes are mostly like. So-and-so carved this rune and again and again. But it gives you the names of the people who were there, and not the timeline. So I've got a sort of grid of that I'll work into the story at some stage. But that was the starting point. And the other thing that was fascinating about this one book was that the suggestion came from this historian that Leif was maybe the daughter of Leifulf, who was the murderer of St. Magnus. And I thought, oh, can you imagine what it's like being the daughter of someone who murdered a saint? A bit tricky, I'd have thought. The rest came from that beginning.
So did they, I don't know anything about St. Magnus, but normally saints and become saints after being martyred. So did he become a saint after being murdered by Leif?
Yeah, absolutely. And he's the head honcho in sainthood for Orkney, because he's an Orkney saint, and because the cathedral was then built for him. So St. Magnus Cathedral is an amazing place to visit. And exactly what you were saying about the places you've just visited, Matthew, that you go there and you know, well, for me, I now know that St. Magnus's remains are there. And so Ronald, who is another key character in the book, he was later sainted as well.
Is this on Orkney? A cathedral?
Yeah.
On Orkney?
Yeah. Mainland.
I never knew that. And I've got a friend that lives there, but I never realised there was a cathedral there.
Yeah, and it was built by the same builders who built Durham.
Oh,
they
wow.
Then headed off to Orkney. And they brought in all these wonderful techniques from the French cathedrals. So from Durham to Orkney.
Mm. Wow, incredible. Another reason to go to Orkney if we needed another.
Yeah, I've been trying to avoid friend, but
I'd love to go up to Orkney. Well, if you're going to go up there, Stephen, and you've got a friend that we can take us out for a drink or something, or even stay in his house, then give us a shout, because I'd love to go up to Orkney, and I could follow. It could follow in the long tradition of me writing books that take place in places and then visit them years later. I very rarely manage to visit places until after I've written the book and it's been published, because I've got in A Night of Flames. They end up in Orkney for a while, and it wasn't planned, but that book came out earlier this year.
Well, I hope you haven't got any forests there.
No, there's no forests. There's not very much there at all. I mean, I do.
That's just as well.
I do try to do some research. I don't just make it up. Well, I do. But...
Oh, well, when I went there, I had no idea what it's like. And when I'm on my own, I wing it a bit and do things that I wouldn't be allowed to, because they're not safe if I'm in company. And I arrived at this little airport that's like landing in someone's living room. And I thought, yeah, you know, even here, there'll be a taxi. Yeah, a taxi. Nope. So I potted around. Nope. No sign of taxis. I went back in and, you know, there's always a nice man you can ask stuff. And I said, is there a taxi here? And then some very, very heavily accented stuff came back, from which I gathered that if it was in Wales, it would have been Jones the taxi, but it was the local equivalent, was delivering some stuff so he could take me with him to do the delivery. So I was sort of bundled into the taxi with a load of rolls of goodness knows what back of a lorry. And he gave me the long way round so he could tell me all about the island. And he said, I am getting to the point of this
That's
story.
Right.
He said, everyone says there's no trees here. And I said, you see, I live in a place where there's huge forested areas. So I didn't know what to say politely. And so I didn't. And he said, there's a tree. And we drove on a bit. He said, there's another tree.
Yeah.
And I think we must have seen six trees before we drove for half an hour. And he was really, really pleased to have shown me all Orkney's trees.
That's it. So you saw the forest of Orkney.
I did.
But it's interesting. Oh, those sort of things are interesting, place. Though, because, I mean, I don't think there were trees there even way back in the Viking times, but it's possible that there were more trees back then and they've all got cut down, because that happened.
Yeah, they've been cut down.
I believe that's in Iceland, isn't it? Weren't there forests in Iceland and they all got cut down? And now it looks very much like Orkney.
Yeah, I think Scotland was heavily deforested.
Yeah.
Orkney would be the same, I would guess.
No, not Orkney. They had a shortage of wood there, and there's all kinds of stuff about how they brought the wood over from Scotland or from Norway, because Caithness belonged to Orkney.
Yeah.
And Orkney belonged to Norway, but they had to import wood, so they used peat and
stone.
A bit of stone.
Yeah, so I've got that actually in the book. I've got the longhouse, or the house where they go, is actually built of wood, of stone, there's a bit of a mention of it. But it's some of the research I did for Orkney, and not having been there, but because they approach by ship, I found some YouTube videos of a guy going around on one of these motorbike things. What are they called? I can't think what they're called. The things he
squats.
They used to be, but in water, like
I know. Like speed, yeah, I don't know what they're called.
Speed bike
jet ski.
A jet ski. I just couldn't think of the word. It's not historical enough. Yeah, so jet ski, and he's bombing around, but he's filming like with a GoPro, and so he's like on Orkney, and he goes out, you know, 2 miles away or a mile and a half away, or whatever. So you can see Orkney miles off with the birds flying around, and then he's talking to the camera. So he's like saying, "Oh, here I am at such and such a beach. You know, I'm going to go look at this crag and this cliff." And it's fantastic though for the sort of writing, imagining them coming up on a long ship. I could get the view. From the from the actual water and see the cliffs as they approach and things like that. So it was interesting. It's amazing what you could
find.
Oh,
that would be a good link for me. I need to watch things to get into them, because I'm not very good with particularly the mechanical side of building and making. I have to actually do it and see it being done.
Well, that, I found some other videos about like making Viking longships as well and everything when I was doing that research. It was I'm a bit, I don't know if it's because I find it easier for it to go in that way, or it's just that I'm lazy and it's easier than reading a book. But yeah, obviously I do read stuff, but I prefer to.
Building a ship, it's much easier to watch it happen than to read. I mean, it's easier to read about it, but you don't really understand it.
That's right. And a guy telling you, and here I chop the wood like this, and this is how I use the axe, and I do this. Mm-hmm.
And,
it's
and the noises it makes, and what the planks minutes, look like. And that's much better than reading it from a book.
Yeah, and I find the same with fight scenes as well. I was watching Gleamer Wrestling on YouTube, as well as the Voyage of the Sea Stallion, where you actually see a replica Viking ship doing that voyage.
That's the one.
Everything.
It's
fantastic.
That's one of the ones
absolutely wonderful.
Really good.
Yeah,
that's brilliant. It's a really good documentary with all the talking to the people on board, and I got loads of little snippets of information out of there and put them into the Night of Flames, which is when they go out on the ship, and all the different things that happen to them basically come from that documentary.
We've probably written up the same stuff then, probably. So I'll have to read that, because I read the journals they wrote from that as well, and there's
some of that stuff.
Right, I read the first of the Benicio Chronicles, and I read Stephen's Druid, but I've been reading so many things for too many people.
Yeah,
you know
it's
like.
So difficult to keep up with everybody. Everybody writes so much, and it's really tough.
Oh, Night of Flames has just gone up my list, so I can check out your Orkney stuff and run away very fast if I've got the same
both
thing.
Both written the same book.
Well, if we've both written similar bits, but I mean, you know, there's only so much you could write about Vikings on ships. But yeah, I mean, they don't spend that long in Orkney. Orkney's a stop off in my book, and then they go off to Norway. But it's more the sort of the sea voyage part. They go up from Northumberland or Northumbria along the coast, and then stop in Orkney, and then go across. I was originally going to have them going straight across to Norway from Northumbria, and then when I started doing research, I realised that's not what the Vikings did. They actually would go across, you know, to the Orkneys or Shetland, and then down. And so I thought, well, I can't really just fly in the face of reality. So that's the way they do it. They go up and they stop there for a few days and then go across. So onto another question, because we talked a lot about the Ringbreaker set in 12th century Orkney. And you mentioned that you've written another series called The Troubadour's Quartet, which is also set in the 12th century, but it's obviously a different place. I believe it's set in France. So there's some links there, which I wasn't aware of. You said that there was this prince from Orkney that appears in those books as well. What are the other links to the books, and what similarities or what differences are there between those two, between that series and this new historical fiction?
Well, I'm going to use a word that makes people run away and is very rude, and you will rarely hear it. I don't think I've heard it on any of your podcasts. Poetry. I think that people are very scared of poetry, and yet when you ask people, they can always remember a line of verse. It sticks with them. And I know you and Stephen have both talked about ballads.
Yeah.
And for me, that's a form of poetry. But it's, you can get away with saying song and ballad, but when you use the P word, people feel threatened, mostly because they've had really shitty teachers in the past who made it so academic and off-putting.
Boring.
And not for ordinary people. Yeah. Boring, absolutely. So the troubadours were the rock stars of the Middle Ages, and they not only performed the songs and wrote the lyrics, they carried the news, some of it fake news. And I was interested in Stephen's work because you looked a lot at the ballads of Robin Hood to draw your stories for that series, didn't you?
Yeah. They were the original tales. So that was what I went back to. Although I'll be honest, I never read the actual old English versions very much. I was more into the translations because they're so much easier to read for someone like me that's not particularly bright. But
we'll ignore that because that's fishing for a compliment.
I ignore those.
You know, it's not really, it's true.
I ignore all those.
No,
yeah.
It's not true.
See, he got it in the end. He got the compliment.
Thanks, he got Jean. It.
Carry on.
Right. So I live in the south of France, and I was reading troubadour poetry because I started off as a poet and I love poetry, and I hope that I taught it in a way that the kids I taught actually thought it was fun, because we used to do everything from Bon Jovi to you name it as poetry. And the book I was reading about the troubadours said that rumor said that there was a young female troubadour in the touring the south of France with a big white dog. Now, my breed of choice are Pyrenean mountain dogs, and the big white dog captured my imagination completely, and I could see her. I could see this girl, and there were women troubadours. So that was where it all started, with a picture in my mind of this girl in a ditch running from whatever had happened to her, and a big white dog, Pyrenean mountain dog, was also running from stuff, and the two of them sort of hooked up. And that's how it all began. But there are four books, and although they start in the south of France, what was then Occitania, they travel to the Holy Land, they ride on camels, they go across deserts, they take their music from the Holy Land down to what's now Catalonia and Zaragoza.
Oh, wow.
And they end up in, this is totally unexpected to me, but they end up in Wales. And the link throughout his song, and the link with the Ringbreaker, is that yeah, okay, I love all the adventure, I love the Crusaders, I love the knights, I love the battles, but it does annoy me sometimes that people don't credit the Vikings for being outstanding poets. Mm-hmm. Just the idea of getting totally pissed in a bar and then standing up and spontaneously rapping with that degree of technical brilliance and making everybody laugh at the same time. Well, could you do it?
Certainly not. No. What is this, flighting? Is that what they called it? Flighting?
I don't know. I haven't heard that word.
Well, this is actually from the game on the Xbox, Assassin's Creed. Which is
right.
The Viking edition that's out just now. And that's what they do in it, flighting, where it's kind of one guy against another, like a rap battle, basically, for Vikings.
Oh, brilliant.
And that's what they do in the game. So it's quite interesting. And they basically just kind of insult each other through rhyme.
Yeah. Well, that is one particular kind of poetry where they do the insults. And that was true in Wales as well. And that was true in France. It was a particular genre of poetry where you just slagged the hell out of whoever you were against as a poet. But there were other kinds as well. And whereas the French poetry has got kind of sexy love lyrics, very sexy, and all those were censored out, they're very rude. I've read a lot of Norse poetry now because that was a lot of my research. And it's far more like puzzles, so that everybody there would work it out. And it's more intellectual than the French poetry.
Yeah, they liked the riddles, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yes, the Anglo-Saxons were really into riddles as well. That was a big, big thing. I think there's a huge link in culture between the Anglo-Saxons and the Norse.
Yeah.
It's very, very similar before the...
Yeah, and this is a period I knew nothing about and a culture I knew nothing about. But one thing I did uncover was that women had far more rights in Viking society than in Anglo-Saxon.
Well, in Anglo-Saxon, they had a lot of rights before they were Christianized. It's the Christianity that takes it all away. So if you go back to the times, but even later, they still have more rights than later in the medieval period, in later medieval, after the Anglo-Saxons. But yeah, if you go back to the time sort of pre-Christianization, really, so sort of 8th century or before 7th century, they have a lot of rights. And even throughout the whole of the Anglo-Saxon period, there's women got left land and men could bequeath things to women, and women could bequeath things, and they could own things in their own right and run things in a way that later in high medieval period they weren't able to. So similar to, see, to the Vikings.
I felt cheated when I found out some of this stuff, because the 19th century picture of medieval women was just fake news, completely fake news.
Well, I think there's definitely moments of history. I mean, definitely the Victorian outlook on history was very strange and skewed things for, I think, for Britain especially for a long time. But in all sorts of ways, in terms of the way that they portrayed, you know, Vikings and women and all sorts of things. But yeah, I think there are definitely periods in history when women in the medieval period didn't have many rights and weren't able to do a lot. But I think there were probably more periods when women did have more rights and more power than has commonly been let on or recognized. But maybe they weren't, you know, maybe they weren't the ones writing the history, and so.
Well, this is why I like the 12th century, because I've uncovered so much what the trendy word is agency by women, where they actually aren't just the power behind the throne, but the damn power. And it's amazing. It's really good fun. And it makes for good stories.
Yeah. Well, you've written history. We talked quite a lot about history stuff. And obviously talk about 12th century medieval. You've done some other stuff as well. You've done I'm just looking at the list of things and to cover here. You've also done fantasy, done a fantasy trilogy called Natural Forces. You've done some Second World War stuff as well. So you've covered different. So Second World War is a bit of a jump from okay. Medieval, and you know, then the fantasy as well is quite a leap away from, I suppose there's some, you know, connections, but how does that all come about? And do you just jump from one project to the next, or is there not really a plan behind it all?
I've written and published 25 books now, and the first one was in 1988. And in those days, there was no self-publishing as there is now. So I was seeking a publisher and writing when I could, day job, all the rest of it. But I didn't find the publisher of my dreams. I found three for different ones. It wastes a lot of time. And so what I suddenly realized was that I wanted to write what I wanted to write, because I wasn't commercial. I wasn't fitting in. I didn't have to earn the money. And I've got a drawer full of ideas, and they compete. They say, write me, write me, write me. And then when one is noisy enough, that's the one that I go for next. But World War II was special, because that's actually nonfiction, and it's based on my father's diary.
Okay.
He was in World War II Malta as a young Scottish soldier.
Right.
And he kept this diary illegally. He'd have been court-martialed if it was found, and wrote it up for the 4 years when Malta was bombed and won a George Cross for all the horrors that they nearly starved to death on the island. And my father stayed in the army, so this diary was a secret. But as a little girl, I was very nosy, and I knew it existed, even though I never actually got to see it. You know, I knew there was this hidden thing. And after my father's death, my mother said, is there anything of your father's that you'd like? And I said, I want his diary. Oh, right. This did not go down well
really?
With my mother.
That's really interesting.
And she thought about it, and first of all, she let me read it in front of her.
Wow.
So I couldn't take it away. I could sit there.
Sounds like being given the script for a new Star Wars movie or something. You know, they lock people in a room and say you can't take it away.
Yeah, absolutely. And the reason she didn't want me to have it was because she didn't come off very well in it.
Oh dear.
All right.
They were together then, you see. They were engaged. And for 5 years they didn't see each other. And my mother had the time of her life. She had a great time. She was riding her bicycle around Scotland, flirting with every man in the entire neighborhood, and she was in the Women's Army Corps, and she was having a great time, and her fiancé was going through hell in Malta.
He's nearly starving to death, and she's riding around Scotland, having a great time on that bike.
But what makes this so poignant is she didn't know. He couldn't tell her because the letters were censored. And that was what drove him to writing the diary, because he had to say the truth to someone or he'd go bonkers. And she would write these letters saying, I haven't heard from you for a while. And she even sent him blank writing paper. And he walked across the island to the post office because he thought there was a letter from her. And he shredded his feet because he had all kinds of physical problems from life as it was. And it was the sarcastic present of blank paper because she wasn't writing to her.
All right.
So there were some hard bits for her to remember. But when things got even worse and he was going to be moved, because the final push, he went to Monte Cassino in Italy, and that was going to be so horrific that he shipped the diary back, smuggled it back with a mate, because he had no leave in 5 years.
Wow.
He was from hell on Malta to Monte Cassino. And the diary went back to my mother.
Right.
And then they kept it. They got married.
So then she read. So she read this diary before
when he was still out
before
there.
He came back. I bet she felt. But she felt bad.
I have to make up for that. Eh? Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, what can you do? She didn't know.
Yeah.
And so she felt that was the real problem, and also. The reason it was kept secret was because he stayed in the army and he finished up as a major. And that was seriously, seriously career-killing stuff that he had in that diary. And now it just seems we know what war is. Mm. But there's an incident of friendly fire recorded in there when an Italian prisoner of war ship is torpedoed and goes down. And the prisoners were all British. So actually, the British forces killed hundreds of prisoners.
And that was all just hushed up, obviously, at the time, never mentioned. Yeah.
Yeah. So you've got all of that, and he was only 22. And so the I could talk about this for hours, but the story, as I tell it, takes him with diary extracts through from that first moment when he signs up. And they thought they were on holiday. It was the first time all these young men had gone abroad, and he went to Malta and there were palm trees and sunshine. And then, of course, it gets dark, very dark.
Wow.
So I felt like I was writing it with him. And I've got to tell you this bit because it's a fabulous story. I couldn't write it up till my mother was dead. She did give me the diary, but she'd then... 10 years after my father had died, they had 40 years together. And then 10 years after his death, she married again. And I didn't want to write about their love for each other, my mother and father, when she was having a new relationship. Mm. It wouldn't have been kind. So after she died, I sort of grieved for her and for my father writing this book. And I wanted some information on the family. And my father's brother was living in Canada, if he was still alive. He would be in his 80s. So I sent him a letter and said, I'm writing up my father's war story. Any chance of you helping me with some family stuff? And he emailed me back and he said, well, yes, of course. And he became a really close friend. He was in touch every day. And at one point he said, aren't you interested in my war story? Is it all about George all the time? I thought, oh my God, sibling rivalry, here we go. And he was a prisoner of war in France for 4.5 years. And I wrote up his memoir, which is very different because that was his story from the past. But they were chalk and cheese as characters. And my uncle was just so much fun and got up to so much mischief. He was always trying to escape. And he in Scotland in those days, they taught French in schools, and his French was very good. And he did, he kept trying to escape via local girls, via you name it. He was out there up to mischief. So I felt like I was getting the bulletins from World War II because I had my father's diary and my Malta research and I'd my uncle's stuff coming in at the same time. And I was writing that. Oh, it was tremendous. Come really on. Tremendous.
Brilliant. So that explains it. I'd seen you had these sort of couple of books set in the Second World War, and they looked like memoirs or things. It was interested to see that, you know, such a different thing. So that makes a lot of sense.
But, you mentioned France a bit there, and I had a look at your website, your photography website, which is really, really good. And the French landscapes in particular, the photographs of them, like the daisies and stuff, they're just fantastic.
Thank you. So, I go on.
Sorry, there's no real question. I thought you might want to mention it because it is really good. So I assume it's a big part of your life.
Yeah, I wasn't a photographer when I moved to France, but it was the landscape that inspired me, and I started taking photos to show the folk back home. And that's 20 years ago that I've moved to France from Wales. And I've got friends who are very good photographers. And then I joined in stock photography with iStock and Getty Images and learned the trade to actually have the technical quality of photography, worked with professionals. And this year I had my first solo exhibition as a photographer. So that's been a hugely important for me. And I've really enjoyed it. So it's been a mixture of the commercial through stock photography. And then I've turned to art. And it's a lovely change from writing. You know, the way you've had too much of words and you just want to be with something else, something active. Or so I know Matthew walks the dog. I'm sure you walk the dog as well. And I knit, I cook, but being out there with my camera is a different way of getting out and about and away from the words.
Yeah, definitely.
Stephen plays guitar.
Yeah.
Explore your
artistic side in a different way, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just looking at some of the photos. I tried to look earlier and for some reason the website wouldn't open for me before, but it's open now and must have just been a glitch in the system. But yeah, they're amazing. Really great photos. So anyone listening, fully recommend you go and look on Jean Gill's website and then click through to her, what do you call it, to the
galleries.
The galleries, that's the one, yeah.
Yeah, and the gallery that's there that shows the blacksmith working in a forge, I had to talk him into letting me do the shoot, but I'm fascinated by Damascene steel. That's the 12th century side. And this young blacksmith was working in the market and I asked him if he'd make a knife for me.
Right.
And that I could photograph the whole sessions. And he wasn't keen. You can imagine this little old lady saying, I want to take photos of you. And yeah, okay, he's got a job to do. And so I talked my way into an interview, in a way, up at the forge. And the forge is up in the mountains, if you can imagine. In the middle, it's the forge in the forest from a fantasy novel. It's just amazing. Right. So I went up there and I took my most expensive lenses with me. So I had all the gear and I got it out. And as soon as he saw the gear, he thought I was a good photographer, whereas, of course, that's a load of shit. You can have a lot of expensive gear, and all it means is you've got the money to buy expensive gear. But that helped. And then we talked about what he wanted out of the shoot, and I spent 4 half-days shooting the making of my knife, and it's on my YouTube channel as a slideshow, but it was just magical. And then whenever I write the blacksmith character in my medieval or my fantasy novels, I think back to that. So I have a Damascene steel knife because I seem to remember that all your guests seem to have weapons and know how to use them. Well, I have absolutely no idea how to use weapons, but I have a Damascene steel knife.
Well, that's amazing. I did. My wife paid for me to go to a forge to do like a day of forging. In a forge, you could see Glastonbury Tor from the forge.
Yeah.
And the guy was an old, I think he was Austrian. Well, I was going to say he was old. He wasn't that old. He was probably in his late 50s. He was a guy from Austria. I think he was Austrian. And he was amazing. And he hand-forged stuff. And he was like a master bladesmith. And he'd done pattern-welded seaxes and all sorts. Yeah. He was incredible. Yeah. And real character. And I really enjoyed the day there. And we talked a bit about that I was writing, and we talked about Anglo-Saxon stuff and everything. And he said, you know, you can come back and you could do a bigger blade, you know, because I didn't do a blade. I just did some stuff, you know, but it was like a, you know, poker and twisting metal stuff, because I was in there for a day. But he said, come back and you could do another course and do like a, you know, I do things where you can make a whole sword or whatever, or a knife or things. And I was like, yeah, I'll do that. Sounds like a great idea. And about 3-4 weeks later, I looked him up on Facebook, and he died of a heart attack just a couple of weeks later. So sad. I was so excited, looking forward to going back.
And doing it,
when you meet someone and you think, oh, this is a great contact, I'd love to go back and meet this, you know, carry on talking to this guy. And it was literally just like weeks later, and he passed away.
So. It's a privilege to meet people like that and to watch them work. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned pattern welding and the real Damascene steel. They can't make any more, can they? No. They've lost the secrets and the materials. And so I had a long chat with a reader who got in touch with me, who is a Viking reenactor who used to be a blacksmith, and he has all kinds of theories about how they might have done it. And he said, truthfully, they were more skilled than we have the patience to be.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely about patience and time and effort. I mean, and obviously knowledge as well. But I think there's a big difference between Damascene and pattern welded. Actually, they're two different things, but they're often the same word is used to describe them because they look similar.
Yeah, and I think pattern welding is as close as we get to the original Damascene. But the way that my blacksmith worked, it's not engraving on the surface. It is folding and folding and folding.
Yeah, I think that's
with the two different types.
I think we could go into a whole different long discussion about this, but I think Damascene is obviously comes from Damascus, and it's a different thing than pattern welding. And I think pattern welding is very much the Anglo-Saxon and Norse style of twisting the rods and hammering them together. Before they're forged, it's not folding after they're forged.
Mine doesn't fold after they're forged. Mm. It's part of the process.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's not Damascene steel as it was.
No,
I'm just using the term as a shortcut, but you know, we can have a really, really long discussion on that because it's interesting. But I noticed Stephen has dropped out now, so I think
he's glazed over. Yeah.
I'm just thinking of the time because we're not even halfway through our questions list that we've got for you.
Okay, I'll do short answers.
50 minutes.
That's all right.
So I'm trying to, Matthew's talking away, and I'm trying to think, right, what can we go to next? Where can we go?
Well, so go on about dogs. It's got to be the next thing to talk about.
Well, you love dogs. You've written about dogs. You've translated books about dog training. And I noticed that one of your books is about a medieval Christmas story with a dog as a star. And I write Christmas books as well because I love that time of year. And it's good fun to write about that. So how did you find that experience of a dog being the star of a Christmas story?
Well, that's the dog from the Troubadours Quartet. Yeah. So that one was easy because it's a revisiting the story from a different point of view.
Right.
And that's the second time that I'd written as a dog. So I was sort of used to that because I wrote a modern dog story from a dog's point of view. And that's actually the one, that's my bestseller, if you like, that someone to look up to is the one people like the best. And what I did in both of them was to show dog training from the dog's point of view. And it's very different when you think like a dog.
Yes, I bet it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
So do they have dialogue and stuff? I assume they do.
They think, and they have internal monologues going on.
Yeah, and it's a really, I'm not someone who writes sentimentally about animals, so there's some quite rough bits because I like dogs being dogs. Mm. But there's still that decision about, in order to communicate, you've got to actually use language a dog wouldn't use. So it's finding the halfway house, if you like, that still has a doggy feel about it. So, for instance, in the modern dog story, they're in an animal shelter and the dogs are telling each other the story of how they came to be there at twilight. And you know from your dogs, at twilight, the dogs all start barking to each other. And they're communicating. Now, what they're saying not something I can promise you I've got right. But in the shelter, they bark their stories, and the other dogs listen and join in sort of pack solidarity. And you'll hear that as well.
Yeah, I was
all the dogs barking together.
Yeah. Find it amusing. The other day, I think it was just yesterday night, we were walking Blue, and we walked past a fence, and the dog inside the garden. It was dark already, sort of just after, you know, about sort of this time in the evening, and the dog barked, and Blue just went mental and started pulling and sort of growling back. And I always joke and sort of say that the dog said something, you know, rude to him or whatever, you know, because he got like really, sometimes he'll just ignore the dog barks. And he doesn't, And I was saying to the wife, I was going, he was like, you know, saying back to the dog, like pretending to be Blue. And I was like, going, you know, I'll have you so-and-so. And I was basically imagining what this dog had shouted to him, you know, saying, exactly. Oh, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly what I did. And I always, when my Pyrenees in particular did the twilight thing, because that's their job, is to keep the wolves away, even when there aren't any wolves. And I used to say, how many Dalmatians are missing again?
Yeah.
So the dogs like Christmas as much as we do?
No.
No. Not interesting.
Not at all. I never do Christmas presents for dogs.
And I just meant in your book.
Special food. Oh, in the book. Oh, well. Right. In the Christmas tale one, it's actually very medieval. Mm-hmm. And you've got the dogs in the sheepfold. And it is the story of a Pyrenean mountain dog's life looking after the sheep. But it's also the story of him finding the troubadour, that girl I mentioned earlier, and how that came to be.
So what he's running from at the beginning of that. And,
yeah, exactly.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
So I see you've done, you know, we've talked about all these different things that you've done, writing all different styles and photography and all the different stuff. You've also done some translating into English, I presume, from French.
Yeah. I would only ever translate into my mother tongue.
Yeah.
But the translation came from the dog training.
Okay.
Through online forums for Pyrenean mountain dogs, I came across a dog training book by Michelle Hasbrook, which I really thought was good. And we're going back 18 years now, and I wrote to him. Because sometimes it's nice to write to an author. And I said, I love your book. Yeah, I'm a fangirl. If I really like an author, then I might do that. And I asked if he could recommend someone writing in English who had the same theories and principles and practice. And he said, well, why don't you translate my book into English?
Seems reasonable.
And I thought, well, why don't I? Oh, bugger this, I'll do it. And I then went to, I did that, and I found a very, very good publisher in the UK. You know, Sod's Law, I couldn't place my own books, but I could place that one. And I went to do dog training with him. He had he was French, but he lived in Switzerland. So the joke was that I'd take my dog to Swiss finishing school. Yeah. But amazing, amazing experience.
That's great.
And yeah, so the French publisher of that book, I was then in contact with, and he got in touch with me a couple of times to translate books. And I knew that I ought to be writing my own, but I often stop and think, what do I actually want to do? So
well,
I thought, oh, bugger it. And when someone offers you a lot of money, I can't say that I didn't notice that.
I was going to say, so you've got to make a living as well. So yeah, if somebody says to you, you know, do you want to write something or translate something, you know, then
And I love translation. I learned from it. It was very, very good. So I did a couple of books for that big French publisher.
That's interesting. So all of those different writing styles that you've worked on, historical fiction and memoir and translation, poetry, fantasy, modern, which do you prefer of all of those different sort of writing things? Which would you choose to, if you could only choose one of them, to continue doing?
I think I'm 67 in 2 weeks' time, and I think there are different genres for different times in your life. I've written for television as well. I never actually got past the second round for EastEnders, thank God. I tried all kinds of things. So some of it was experimentation, I think. And the poetry that I started off with was when I was in the turbulent 20s and particularly miserable. Mm-hmm. And I think misery and poetry, you know, the Bon Jovi, like a poet needs the plane. I think there was a little bit of that to writing only poetry. And at the moment, I'm really happy in the 12th century.
Yeah.
But the fantasy came around because I was very angry about the environment.
Okay.
And because I keep bees, and I'd be being stung by 50 of the little buggers when I mishandled them and had a horrible experience. And a friend said, what if you'd had superpowers from that? And so I had to write the story about that then.
Yeah, well, that makes sense.
It's interesting. Well, it did to me.
It's interesting you said about the poetry, and because I remember when I was doing English at school, A level, which I failed, but the thing I most liked about English literature was, or one of the things I most liked, was Keats. And of course, he died when he was 25, and it was all misery and unrequited love and dreadful. And I was 18, you know, and so it was perfect. Yeah, you know? That sort of romantic poetry is brilliant.
Absolutely perfect. And, you know, Keats being half in love with easeful death and wonderful. But he lost me when the lover died and the girlfriend buried his head in a pot of basil.
Yeah, yeah.
That had me hysterically laughing.
It's based on a Boccaccio, isn't it? Isn't it based on a classical poem or something?
I still think it's hilarious.
And how she cries over the pot of basil, and the basil grows extra big because it's in the.
You know, I'm sorry, but just no, no, no. That's not what you do.
I think, but it's probably sort of 12th century or something. I think it's based on something from 13th, 12th century something.
And I remember a Middle English story, similar. But not the one that's derived from, where she kept his corpse under her bed and brought it out every night to kiss it.
We've all done it.
Actually, that sounds familiar. I'm sure there's some true crime stories where people have actually done that.
I'm sure it does. Yeah, but it's not romantic.
No, well, to them, I assume it is.
Please don't tell me you think it's romantic. Well,
certainly, I don't. I'm sure some weirdo does.
Obviously, Keats thought it was romantic, but he was very weird. He was like Jim Morrison in the early 19th century, wasn't he? Really, it's all about looking forward to death and just being weird.
I wanted to ask you, Jean, being Welsh, have you ever thought of writing about the history of that country? Because I think Wales is often overlooked in historical fiction. Its influence isn't really properly appreciated.
Totally agree. And I'm adopted Welsh, I have to confess here, because with a soldier father, I had a nomadic childhood. But I moved to Wales when I was 22 and lived there longer than anywhere else. And so it's as much my country as anywhere is ever going to be. And I did write quite a lot about the 12th century history in a couple of my books. One is The Last of the Troubadours books, and also in a children's story. And I agree that it's underrepresented, but I found a great deal of prejudice against Welsh history among publishers and in bookshops. Mm. I did my teenage and university years were in York, and I did a reading there when my first novel came out. and had the joy of a book assistant yelling from one end of the room to the other, "No, it's set in Wales, so it won't sell."
Wow.
I suppose I understand that, but I think people think that that history is all English when it's actually Welsh. They just lump it in as Welsh.
I don't think the Welsh think that.
No, the Welsh don't, but I think people in England or Scotland or America, whatever, they think the Welsh history is actually English history when it's not.
Yeah, I think there's a bit of that, but also it's just not ever managed to get trendy. I've done a couple of festivals back in Wales, really great festivals, and I was chairing a panel for Welsh crime writers. And the question came up as to whether they felt it was more difficult. And there was, there's that great detective series on TV that's set in Wales.
Is that Lewis or something?
A dark one. Can't remember the name of it now, but it was very popular at the time. And it was a breakthrough to actually have that going mainstream in the UK. And they said there is a prejudice against the crime writing set in Wales, against TV series set in Wales going across the UK. And there are breakthroughs. It did look as if it was changing, but it's still more difficult. That's the experience. I can only talk about the experience of the writers I was mixing with. And I've certainly had that. And with my moment in York about, it won't sell because it's set in Wales, they also said that if it was set in India, it would be fine because books set in India were popular. Right. So it wasn't that they wanted books set in England. It was specifically not Wales.
I mean, from thinking of that from a logical perspective, I'm thinking, okay, subcontinent of India, you have nearly a billion people. You have I don't know how many million, 5 million people in Wales or something. So you're probably, you're opening yourself up to a much larger readership by writing something based in India. I actually thought about that myself. I sort of wondered if I could write something set in India.
No, I don't agree with that, because I think
do you think Wales is as big as India?
Well, it is to me, because obviously size, as is subjective.
Well, I don't know about that.
But I think it depends on readers, and it'd be an interesting one to survey on Twitter and find out whether readers prefer to read books set where they live, because I don't think they do. I mean, I hang out with lots of fantasy writers, so obviously they set their places in other worlds.
Yeah.
Maybe just the accent.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I've been slightly facetious, but I have been to India a few times and there's massive bookshops. So they definitely like to read.
I think it might just be the accent. The Welsh accent is like the Scottish accent. A lot of people don't really understand it. So you're not going to get as many TV shows and things like that. And we're kind of pushed to the side a bit. So I set my Druid books quite a bit of it in England, specifically because of that, just to draw in more readers.
That's really interesting. And I don't think I meant, Matthew, that there weren't the bookshops and the readers in India. I'm just saying that they might read books that aren't necessarily set in India.
No, obviously, yeah, people read books that are set in all sorts of places.
Well, from my own experience, Indian people certainly don't read my books anyway. No matter how much I tried Facebook adverts and stuff, none of them seemed to buy my books.
The first semi-public reading I did of any of my books with The Serpent Sword, when it was before it's published, was actually to some people in India. So there you go.
Did they buy it?
I don't know. There were people. They were a captive audience. There were people I worked with, and they said, "Oh, go on, read us a bit of the book that you've written." Then, so I said, "Okay." So I think it was just about.
It's really interesting finding out where your readers are and what they're like, isn't it? And I think that's one of the things that when you stay in a genre, you get more of a sense. Because I found from advertising that 60% of my readers for The Ringbreaker are men.
Yeah.
And previously it was 60% were women, but I definitely have a lot of men who read my books. So it's no good for my books having covers with, a woman looking
wistful.
thank you for giving a polite word. Yeah. That's fine.
Sexy.
We'll settle on wistful. Yeah. Or sexy.
Normally, the ones I hate is the decapitated woman. There's always the woman's body with no head, looking like, yeah. but sort of with a back to the camera and wistfully sort of staring yeah. out over the sea.
But that was a fashion, wasn't it? And the fashions change, and you can't change your covers every time the fashion in them changes.
Yeah, that's true.
I think you're right, because I'm sure Matthew's the same. Our readers, historical fiction, are mostly men, and they're mostly in the UK or America. And funnily enough, the stats for this podcast are exactly the same. The listeners are the same.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Yep. Oh, that is interesting. Yeah. No, I didn't know that.
And they're all yes. of a certain age. They're all kind of over, like, 35.
Not all, but yeah, majority.
Most of them,
yeah,
the vast majority are basically like us, really.
Yeah, basically you write stuff that, I suppose you write what you like to read, and then similar people will read
but
it.
I read books like this when I was in my 20s as well, but it doesn't seem to be catching on with the younger audience the way I would have expected or hoped.
Yeah, I just don't think they're reading as much, I suppose. Although saying that, my daughter now started reading loads, so I don't know.
Yep. My daughter reads all
But she's not reading this sort of stuff at all. So no. She reads fantasy. No. She's really into fantasy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. one of my readers then.
Yeah, yeah. So from previous, so changing the subject, moving away from history for a minute, from previous email conversations that we've had before, like in the build up to this, I know, Jean, that you're into rock music. You're into lots of different types of music, but you let drop into conversation that you liked rock music and that you've seen some great acts over the years. I wanted to ask you, what was the first gig that you ever went to?
Well, certainly the first one I remember going to was a bit of a shocker. I lived in York when I was in my teenage years, and they used to have some great rock bands playing in the school halls there. You can't believe it now that they were touring. And later I saw Status Quo twice, for instance, so that was quite a big name band in those days. But the one that stayed in my mind, and I checked online to see whether my memory was just, you know, shot to hell and I was making things up, but nope. December 1970, when I was 14.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. As a 14-year-old, I went along with my older boyfriend and his mates, and we went to Nunthorpe School Hall, where we saw Hawkwind.
Wow. Right, with Lemmy.
And yeah. And see, my eyesight's terrible. And I don't like wearing glasses. So I went without my glasses because I hadn't even told my boyfriend that I wore glasses. And that was going to be a big shock for him, I thought, that would finish things. So no glasses, couldn't see anything. And yeah, one of the mates came up and said, "Did you see that? The drummer came on naked." And of course, I didn't have my glasses on. So I had no idea, but I was hoping that the strobes would stop so I could get a closer look, you know. Because a naked man was, you know,
pretty unusual,
novelty for a 14-year-old. And I still don't know whether the drummer came on naked. But nobody ever owned up to having told me a lie. And so I chose to believe that that was the case and I'd missed it. And the story of my life, you know, I'm there and I just don't see the exciting things going on. But when I looked up online, because I knew I was coming on this podcast, and I thought, what interesting things do I know about rock bands? And apparently they used to have a naked dancing girl Saskia. Come with them. Right.
He knows, obviously. Obviously Stephen knows.
So
completely naked as well.
But surely to goodness,
fantastic.
even my mates would know the difference between a naked man and a naked girl.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. I think you would. If you'd seen the pictures, I think you would see the difference.
Yeah.
She was rather attractive, wasn't she? I mean, she was, you know, they didn't put her dancing
busty,
naked.
Busty.
Yeah.
Well, so I've missed it all anyway.
Had Saskia on one side of the stage, a naked drummer in the middle, and Lemmy on the other side.
Wow.
And all I remember is as with most of the concerts, you're in a small school hall and they had strobes and they had the energy was incredible. And of course the dancing we did then, it wasn't a couple dancing. It was a gang of you just going crazy and headbanging. And actually, one of the guys did give another a black eye once dancing. So pretty fierce.
Yeah. Same proper mosh pit sort of style dancing then.
It was completely.
I was going to ask what you. Well, there was a question.
The best one, I assume it's the same question. What was the best concert you went to, the most memorable?
Much more recent. Al Stewart was one of the best ones. I don't know if you have come across him, but he was a big name in the 70s with the sort of lyrics that I was writing as poetry, where you really splurged all your emotions about your girlfriend, boyfriend, everything that had gone wrong. But he was clever with it. And he turned up at Pontardawe in South Wales 25, 30 years ago. And he thought he was playing Swansea, because Pontardawe is somewhere nearby. But again, it was a small hall instead of the huge Swansea venue that he was expecting. And he just, you could see him mentally adjusting, you know, okay. And there was him and his guitar, and he took requests from the audience. I've never seen anyone do that.
Mm.
And we would just call out which song we wanted. And he could play it. And he was quite absolutely brilliant. But there's a few concerts stay in my mind. But I'll go for that one because it's from the rock era and just amazing.
I love the you saying that you could see him sort of mentally adjusting to the fact that it wasn't quite what he expected. But I love that. I mean, that's a true performer that can
get thrown
into a difficult situation and think, okay, this isn't what I expected, but I'm still here to do a job and I'm still going to do the thing, because I suppose some prima donna type artists you can imagine storming off and saying, I'm not playing here, you know. So.
Yeah, because he was a really big name, and he still made recent albums that are quite interesting.
Brilliant. Well, we've talked about pretty much the gamut of stuff, but obviously we can't talk forever.
Nope.
But there's one thing that we do ask everybody. We've asked a lot about music already, so one thing we do ask everyone is, what are you reading at the moment? What have you been reading over the last couple of weeks?
Yeah, on the non-fiction, I've been reading Secrets of the Viking Navigators by Leif K. Karlsen. I don't know if have you come across that one?
No, but it sounds interesting.
It's absolutely brilliant. I think it came out in 2018. And at the same time, I bought myself a sunstone.
Oh, right. Okay.
Which is Iceland spar, which is a kind of calcite, which they might have used as one of their navigational tools, because I couldn't understand it without having one.
It's one of those things that I keep on reading about it, and they say, you know, you held it up so you can see the sun. It's like, what? I've never understood it either. I've never understood how they're supposed to.
So I've got the book, I've got the sunstone, and all I need is a foggy day. And I've tried to talk my man into navigating around the garden with a sunstone in the fog, but he's just not really into it. And so if the two of you felt like coming over,
it was only work in the fog.
Well, it's supposed to be well otherwise you can see the sun.
You don't exactly what he said. If you can see the sun, you don't need it.
All right,
because
what
you do, I'll give you the technical stuff because I've worked so hard on this, that it's a crystal which is in rhomboid form, which is like a squashed rectangle. And because of that, it does this double refraction thing. So if you put one dot on the top of it, it'll show you two dots when you look through
it. That's the direction of the sun.
Well, the two dots, when they're, I've heard two different versions of this now, so I've yet to confirm, but one says when the two dots look the same, you're in the direction of the sun. That's the lightest part of the sky. But the other version says that when they're on top of each other, that's where the sun is. So I'm going to experiment now, and I'll let you know how that goes. And if anybody listening to this knows which is right as to how you navigate with this form of calcite and your dot on the top, join in.
Yeah, so that's probably the best description I've had I've heard so far. Normally, it's quite a vague sort of thing, which makes me think that historical fiction authors who've mentioned the Sunstones don't really fully understand, or they can't replicate how it was used, and they sort of fudge it a bit and just sort of say, yes, they held up the stone to the sky and, oh, they saw the way. And
hallelujah.
Yeah, because yeah, then it's,
I,
you know,
no,
you
I don't think so.
You can fudge it a bit, I suppose, but...
No, the science is good with this because it's called optical calcite. And the quickly, just to say that I always need books on the go, and my fiction read at the moment is The World Breaker's Requiem by Luc Tarzian, which is fantasy, and it's lyrical and weird and different, and it's like an opium dream, and I love it. Wow. And not that I know what an opium dream is, but I have read the
book. You can't
convince
us now.
Yeah. Right. And the reason I chose that is it was a semi-finalist in the self-published fantasy blog-off run by bestseller Mark Lawrence.
Yep.
Yeah.
But, so 300 books go in and they get churned around by 10 blogs. I got churned around, didn't come out. And the 10 finalists then have a contest between them. But it throws up some great, great fantasy reads.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, so, I've seen Mark Lawrence mention that, but I've not really followed the, you know, how it goes. But yeah, it's interesting.
Well, you like, I know the two of you read epic fantasy.
Yeah,
you'll find some crackers there. Absolute crackers.
For me, the most difficult thing is finding time to read at all.
Yeah,
that's my main problem.
Novels. Yeah. All I read is non-fiction.
Although I have read a really good novel this week. So I've actually finished reading an advanced copy of Battle Song by Ian Ross.
Oh, which, I like this week's, yeah.
Ian Ross did Roman stuff. And if he's listening to this, I've actually sent him a nice quote to use on the cover. It's not out until next March. So he can use a nice quote, but he's not responded. So, you know,
Get
your act together, Ian. Anyway, it's really
no
really
no good. Sell me the quote. I'll use it.
I'll sell you a quote.
Yes,
okay.
Absolutely fantastic. Loved every second.
If you bring him a can of Tennant Super, he'll sell
yeah.
It.
No. Just, you know, we'll negotiate afterwards.
Well, it actually is a great book though. I really enjoyed it. It's set in the mid 13th century, and a real
well, you just
departure.
Changed the century on that. We're there.
It's a real departure for Ian Ross, but very, very good. And yeah, at some point maybe you'll see the great quote that I said. But my basic take was that his Roman books are great. This is even better. Really, really good. Really enjoyed it.
His Roman books are good. I listen to the Audible versions. Mm. So, Jean, what have you been listening to? And do you listen to music when you write?
Yeah, sometimes.
I can see behind you, you've got quite a collection of CDs there.
Yeah, I like to see covers. I'm just not very good at knowing which tracks are there on this modern download it stuff. So I like having the CDs. But I've, like you, I'm listening to audiobooks, and I had lectures by Dr. Jackson Crawford, Norse Myths and Legends, and you got to listen
to
his YouTube.
I've listened to him. He's American guy, isn't he?
He is. He's a cowboy.
Yes,
he's right
yeah,
up your street.
He's called Cowboy and Norse. I've seen quite a few of his YouTube things.
Yeah.
And I thought, this guy is like he's just a whole level of cool that, you know, he sort of stands like the Colorado Mountains or the Rockies or whatever, doesn't he? And so there's bits of snow falling.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm just with his cowboy hat, and so I'm going to talk to you about some old Norse now.
What was he called? Jackson Crawford.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've actually got Norse mythology right there. Yeah, I've been listening to that as well.
Oh, it's absolutely, I could listen to him just to listen. He's so easy on the ear and on the eye if you watch his YouTube videos. No, I didn't say that. I think that's, we better think about whether I'm allowed to say
you're
that.
You're going to be cancelled. We didn't say it. You know, it's.
No, I know it was me. I'm old enough
to say.
The, and today on YouTube, I have been listening to Danheim and their Fimble Radio, which is nonstop Viking music.
Really?
So it's just got a rhythmic beat and lots of sound
chanting
that you don't get. Yes, absolutely. But then You know the way YouTube shows you something that's similar and you don't even notice you've switched? And I could not believe it because there's, I'll put the links up afterwards, but there's a new one on the block called Eolya, who's actually made a whole album of the Hávamál lyrics, taking them from the, wait for it, Jackson Crawford translation.
Oh, right, okay. There you go.
And they credit him.
So we come full circle.
The words. Yeah. And I thought, you know, the connections are amazing, aren't they?
Well, the internet as well. I mean, the fact that somebody can do some music like that and actually get people to listen to it where, you know, or us with our books. I mean, the fact that we can get out all this podcast, get things out to people's ears, you know, around the world, or people to read things or see things. It's an amazing time we live in, because it would, you know, yeah, decades ago, it would have been impossible for lots of this stuff to get out there and people to see it and find it. So
nobody would have heard this podcast. It would be a disaster.
It would have been. Before podcasts were invented, we could have done this. Well, on that note, thank you, Jean, for coming along and being such a great guest. It's been
brilliant.
Thanks very
much. Yes, it's been an enjoyable conversation.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I've talked too much, but I've thoroughly enjoyed myself and I love your theme tune. I think you've done a great job with that.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah, I wrote the lyrics for that.
Yeah.
I never actually did that because it was your idea. It was Matthew's idea. The title,
you bastard, yeah. You wrote the lyrics. He actually, one day we'll have to put out the original scratch vocal that Steve did record. So he sent it to me. He sent me the track and said, do you want to record vocals on this? And he said, I've laid down a scratch vocal thing on there. And I listened to it. I was like, God, I don't know about that. And I had to.
It was just me shouting, rock, paper, swords, rock, paper, swords. So yeah, Matthew improved it a bit.
I did something different anyway. But anyway, thanks for coming on. Thanks for the praise about the theme tune. Hang around, everybody, for a couple of seconds, and then you'll be able to hear the theme tune again.
Okay, thanks, Gene.
Well, that's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. Please let us know if you have any questions or things you'd like us to cover in future episodes. You can contact us on the Facebook page. That's facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast. We're on Twitter at @rock_swords without a blue tick. You can find out more about our books on matthewharfy.com and stephenamackay.com. We're both also on Twitter and Facebook. And we love to hear from readers and listeners, so drop by and say hi. The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. Until next time, a Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harvey.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. McKay.
And remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind,
stay safe,
and happy reading.